Good morning, watchers. Welcome to Brother Sal's Sunday Gathering at the Storehouse. Well, I'm so happy to be here once again. I'm very pleased that you're still here listening. I'm very also pleased to see how our list is growing. We're getting many of our old people back that are finding us again and listening to what I have to say. Now, I've been talking to you folks for, I started talking to you in writing in 1993. I started the ministry in the public ministry in 1996 on the internet. And I started broadcasting in December of 2003. And by April of 2004, we had our own radio show and broadcast consistently from then until the time that the market crashed and we lost our sponsor, at which time many tragedies affected all of the people of the world, not just the watchers or not just this ministry, but every place around the world, and everything changed. And there's been a tremendous change in the way things have been accomplished in the world over these years, from 2007 to now, or this last 7 or 8 years. There's a whole new paradigm, and the shift is taking place so that it's become very, very obvious, and it falls in completely with these prophecies that we've been watching all these years, especially the prophecy of Daniel. And I say that because Daniel was written just specifically to lay out the landscape of what it was going to look like at the time when these prophecies are being fulfilled. And I started out telling everyone that before you can even begin to understand, you have to study the prophecy of Daniel. Because without having an understanding of what Daniel was saying and to whom he was saying it, you'd never be able to figure out the end times. And the message is so wide open and so clear and so obvious once you get on the path that there's never any turning back, because history is what this prophecy was written about, and history is what's happening before your very eyes. You are part of the living history that is going on from the day you were born till the day you leave here. The history is in effect for you. Now, we were lucky enough to find out years ago that this period called the end times began. And I said then that we were in the prelude days and you needed to watch it. We formed the watchers, and I said at that time also that it seemed to me that we were kind of a Gideon's army that was being formed. Once again, in history, the Gideon's army was the forerunner of the watchers. Now, I don't care whether you're watching with me or watching alone or watching with somebody else. You're watching. That was the point of the prophecy, and that was the point of what Paul told us to do. He said to watch. You see, he said to watch. Who? He said to watch the Jews. This is all going to happen to them. And it's amazing how many people in the world today, if their minds aren't already closed to the fact that we're not in the end time, that's all baloney, it's already happened, you know, the preterists and the people with the notion that the rapture doesn't happen until after the 1,000 years or whatever. I mean, there are so many stories out there that it's terrible. It really is. And I started the message at that time, long time ago, years ago, about what I had discovered. Because when I came into this, I had come out of the Catholic frame, and I didn't want to have anything more to do with them. I just couldn't believe that any longer, although when I left there with an understanding that God exists and Jesus is the Savior of the world. I carried that with me my whole life, but I didn't know how to worship it. I didn't know anything about it because Catholics don't teach you things like that. And Christianity does, but Christianity teaches it from such a narrow focus that you miss the joy of what God was really saying. And as I started down this trail years ago to watch history to see if, frankly, if God really did exist, because I said, if these prophecies are coming true in my time, and I'm seeing it, and I don't believe that God exists, I got to be insane. And I thought everybody would feel that way. Once you saw with your own eyes the history unfolding before your eyes, you can now take the prophecy as the book that you've read and understood and see the history as a movie that you know the ending to. And with that, you would have the advantage that he put that in the scripture for, so that you would know by watching that the day of your redemption not only is nigh, but you can tell you, he told you exactly when it was going to happen. He gave it to you to the split second, and people don't want to recognize that because their viewpoint is so narrow. They cannot open their or expand their viewpoint to see the Logos of God. In the beginning was the Word, Logos. In the beginning was the story that needed to be told. And God was the only one who could tell it because it was his story. So he was the Word. Then the Word was made flesh. It dwelt amongst us, the human race, people, became a human. Because they weren't watching what they had promised to watch, they missed him. So he put him to sleep, opened it up to the whole world, because the salvation was for the world, but it was to come through the Jews, and Jesus was a Jew, so it could come through him alone. The only one. Why? Because nobody else accepted it. Nobody was around to believe that he was the one, except his apostles. Then he challenged them to go out with nothing. Nothing but the good news, the story, the Logos. You see, the Word of God fulfilled told the story. It was the history that led to the fulfillment that told the story. You could see it. And so the story and the Word of God are one and the same. It depicts forever and all time the history that it lays out and that it fulfills. And then what happens from that fulfillment on? You see? And the prophecy of Daniel brings us with pinpoint accuracy right into a time when you were going to see certain events, because it was all historically based, and anything that's historically based can be debated. That was my whole point. I want a debate. I want somebody to come along with me on this trip so that I'm not the only one who thinks this way. I've written manuscripts, books, teachings. Give them away for free because I don't believe you can make money off the Word of God. That's not my purpose in life. My purpose in life is to teach you what God actually said without the blinders of religion. To expand your viewpoint, not your mind. Just step back another step from where your blinders are, and you will see a whole different world. You will see the Logos of God. now that we're as far along as we are in that prophecy of Daniel, ready for this covenant with many to be made, and you can see something is really going on in history right now. If you're not aware of it, you should be. But just in this past week, the last few, whatever it was since the election, there's a change happening. Can you see it? Now, but the change is different than we think it is, because there's something else going on. The people that we watch that are part of this story, part of this logos of God that is manifesting itself in human time on the stage of present history, you have to watch what they're doing, not what they're saying. Forget what they're saying. You've got to watch what they're doing. Now, events like the Republicans winning as soundly as they did, controlling everything now starting in January, they have this almost the same advantage as the Democrats had when they won the Senate, but they didn't have 60 people, so they haven't got that absolute majority where you pass anything you want, like they did with health care and with everything else, and they just disregarded and made irrelevant their competition during this time, and now the tables are reversed. And so the president was a very liberal agenda. Don't really understand it because he doesn't really say much. What he does is showing you that he's in favor of, you know, crony capitalism and world domination. And his handlers are the people that he's, his base constituency, his base, the people that got him there. They have a plan. We don't know what that is, but we're watching it as we see history develop. And guess what? It's developing exactly like Jesus or the prophets were told by God. Because they said, thus is the word of God. You know, behold the word of God. They didn't say it, behold the word of Isaiah or Jeremiah or Daniel. No. Thus saith the Lord. And so this thing is attributed to what the Lord told them. And you know who the Lord was that they were following at that time. Wasn't a Christian yet. Christ had not appeared yet. The base consistency, my goodness, I can't say it. The base constituency for God was picked out to be this people that he would make an oracle. That oracle was to learn what it was that an oracle needs to know in order that the word of God, the logos of God, the story that he foresaw in doing all of this, because he saw it from the beginning to the end, was to build this oracle people that would bring him into the future until the Messiah would come. They would have the law which they couldn't keep, that was the schoolmaster that showed them they could not keep that law, and therefore the punishment of not keeping the law was what they deserved. And in most cases, it was death. It was very harsh. Why? Well, because he had to show them that he was in control. He was building an oracle people. He was building a foundation of people that was going to grow up through time, that was going to demonstrate to the world who God is through what they did. All based on deeds. It always is. You have to, politicians say this, they don't do it. There was no deed, so did that. It was a campaign promise. It had nothing to do with reality. Don't let anybody think that you don't have to do deeds. What's really true is you don't have to do deeds to get salvation, because salvation was a gift of God. He gave it to you. For what? For your faith. Faith is an action. That's a deed. You see, that's something that you do based on the belief. We understand the belief to be that Jesus is Lord. He's the embodiment of God. When you see me, you see the Father. I do only what the Father does. You see? It becomes the embodiment in human form. To live as a man. To die as a man. But to die to fulfill those prophecies. He paid the price. He was the propitiation. The full price. Thereby now owning that. Even in God's realm. Owning that. Gave him the privilege that a man has. This choice to give it as a gift. Because God gave us free will. So you see, doing it any other way doesn't work. Doesn't fit being God. And so, now the free will comes into play more than ever. Because now you know. But the Jews rejected it. They didn't know. And so the plan that was hidden in the mind of God, the mystery of the church, was revealed. It was only revealed to one man, revealed to Paul. So Paul brings us the viewpoint of a apostatized Pharisee who was one assigned with his zealot heart to go find apostatized Jews, arrest them, and have them receive the punishment of death for what they had done. Not too much unlike what the Muslims do, but that law has been changed now by King Abdullah. But I don't want to go down any holes. I just want to bring you along for a moment to see how the Word of God plays out in history based upon what is said in these prophecies and how their metaphoric value is played out so well that it couldn't be anything else because anything else doesn't fit. So you must watch time as it goes by through the eyes that see that understanding. When you see that, you understand that. It's not self-fulfilling anymore because you've got to wait for it to happen. But you are clued in as to where this thing is going. And if it's still headed that way, well, then you know it's still on track, even if you don't know the details of it. But along the way, there always are enough details that show because they become the milestones by which you move forward and understand at which milestone you are and where you're headed. And ever since this election, when this power change is about to happen in 2 years, and the power change in the governing body of the United States has changed, we've had some interesting things happen. First, North Korea decides to release these prisoners. I'm just going to skim over the top of this so that you can see that. So let's put a dot right there. North Korea prisoners released. Americans. President heads to China. Writes a secret letter to Iran. We got a dot going to China. Got a dot with Iran. President represents his coalition. Okay. His coalition right now includes Russia, so put a dot on Russia. Because they're the key players. France, England, they all got dots. So you got to go see what they're thinking about and what they are doing about what's going on this weekend. or what have they done over the last weeks, that now is the time for all these people to see what to meet and see what America is going to do now, because it's obvious America is the power. And they've joined the coalition of the power to bring about some kind of change. And the timetable just got sped up because there was an election where those people putting forth that agenda are going to be out of there in 2 years, and in a few months they're going to lose complete control of the lawmaking. So everything has been put on a quickened timetable. So it's going to be very interesting to watch and see what comes out of this trip to China. I'm not going to say what they're doing. I'm just saying they're doing something, and it was accelerated. So we got Iran making a deal. I'm not going to say they're making a deal. I don't know what was in that letter. It's not important. What's important is it created a dot. Now, can these dots be linked together? Watch for that in the coming days to see how to link the American and their allies and the major players of the French, the English, the Russians, the Chinese, the Iranians, and watch what's going on in the Middle East. And already in that accelerated movement, we just sent 1,500 more people to Iraq. Some more of these, people who train people. And I was listening to the news today, because I'm still in California, so I see television. And so I was listening to the propaganda today, and they are showing that that's exactly how Vietnam started. And, of course, I was around in those days. And I saw how Vietnam started. I wasn't as deeply interested in what I am in now in those days, but still I was a person who kept up with current events because history had always been my hobby. I love history. As you learn from the past, you know what the future brings. And that when I was introduced to Daniel, I saw that. I saw that in the story of, that God was telling overall. And having come out of a religion that didn't make sense to me, I understood why. Now it didn't make sense to me. I got involved in Christianity. You know, the reborn style. And the teachers that taught me contrary to what the story is telling. And as I got deeper and deeper and deeper into the prophecy fulfillment, from watching it from that end, I see the Word of God as being fulfilled. But with accuracy that just is not ambiguous. So I turned back, I turned to the Bible to start reading it and finding out, what in the world does it really say? Why do these people believe what they believe when God is showing so clearly? Did he miss something in the New Testament? Is it not clear? And I found out it was absolutely clear. Absolutely clear as far as the story is concerned. The logos of God. The reason he would pick a person like Paul is understood. You know, he was a Pharisee. He was a zealot. He was a Roman citizen. He knew the law because of the fact that he was a zealot. You see, you can't be a zealot if you don't know the law. You got to know every little law that you're going out there to accuse these people of. In fact, he was second to Gamaliel. Perfect guy to reveal the story to, that he was waiting for, actually, because he was a zealot for the fact that their Messiah was going to come. And they had to fear a Jew. Boy, he couldn't come to anybody that wasn't a Jew. Therefore, if you left the faith, you see, if you walked away from that, they had to kill you so that you couldn't pass on your genes, because you were a chosen people. They keep that same law today. You don't kill anybody anymore, of course. But they don't let anybody proselytize. You can't go to Israel and talk about Jesus. Although you can come to Israel and go through the stations of the cross, because that's a separate religion that just happens to have happened on that territory. But anyway, these are a separate people. And what was supposed to happen to them has happened. They're back in their land. And the things that Roy Neuberger is talking to them about are the things that we should be watching with eyes open wide and ears just listening, because he's talking the story that Paul told us to watch that I've been watching for 34 years that's actually happening in history. And every week now it's speeding up and more dots are being added that need to be connected. And once they're connected, then they're going to be placed in their part of the tapestry that we're looking at from a very wide angle up here in the balcony. By the way, I hope you enjoyed the conversation I had with Brother Raymond last week. And I mean, I want to tell you, this is one of the most brilliant men that I've ever known. And he has the ability to relate what's going on in the world, because his beat is the world. And we know that we're focused on this little Middle East and the players down here, because they're the beginning of the reasons that these things happen, because it's happening because of them. And so it turns out there's another bunch of kings up above them that are manipulating, and that's what we're watching. And here's what those kings are doing this week because of that election. And Iran is definitely connected to North Korea. North Korea just let go some people, and Iran is about probably ready to make a deal on nuclear or whatever, which if you go back in my teachings and my programming some years, you will find that I said they will finally have to let Iran have their nuclear, peaceful nuclear aspiration, because they can't stop them. They're a sovereign country. You see? And now we need their cooperation. With what? Getting rid of ISIS? We hired them. We're going to get rid of them anytime we want. In fact, I see that they were trying to kill the leader of it, so that's even been accelerated, huh? See, you got to look at yourself now in an accelerated mode. Why is everything accelerating all of a sudden? Because, well, Paul said it was going to come quickly, didn't he? Yeah. Sudden destruction comes upon them. You know, Jesus says, I come quickly. Hang on to what you got. Don't let any man steal your crown. So wait a minute now. Man has to steal your crown. God's not taking it away from you. Why? Because he gave it to you as a gift, and God's not an Indian giver. It's what they used to be called. I don't know if that's okay to say anymore, to connect giving with Indians is something that they take back. I don't know. That's what it's called. Well, don't we get any letters about that, please? But God is not going to take his gift back from you. You don't do that. You give a gift to someone, and then it's theirs, and they can do with what they want. You get a necktie for Christmas. The person doesn't want it, Doc, but it was for you. Whether he wants it back or not. If he wanted one, he bought one for himself also. Now, what you do with that is your business. If you want to give it to the Goodwill to sell in their store, that's okay. You really hate it so much you have to destroy it, so you get a pair of scissors and chop it up in little pieces and throw it in the fireplace, that's okay. Does anybody have to know? No. Unless you want them to. You see what I'm saying? God gave you a gift, and then he gave you free will to do with that gift with what you would. So it belongs to you now. And what does he ask for that? What is the gift all about? That's the next important thing to find out. It's the gift of love. It's the gift of perfection through him, not through you, because you can't do what he said. He said, I'm going to take all these laws that the Jews learned from that they couldn't keep, and they were supposed to learn from that, that they needed salvation, and he was the one that was going to come to save them. And there's a remnant of those left, but the rest of them don't believe that anymore. He put them to sleep, so they couldn't be swayed by anybody. They had to keep doing what they were supposed to be doing. They're under the law. But he changed all of that, and he says, I'm going to give you exactly what I want from you, unambiguously. No. You don't need anything else to understand, but here's who I am. I'm love. God said, I am love. Jesus comes. He's a personification in the flesh, living love. Forgives everyone for everything. Loves his neighbor just like he loves himself. You see? He does unto others as he would have them do unto him. And he loves God above all else. And he brings us that message, walking among us, making miracles, giving the power of miracles to his disciples, but they had to go out in a certain way. No shoes, one tunic, no staff, no money belt, just the word. Let it grow on that. When they accepted that and they did that, they had the right of judgment because they could raise people from the dead. So they had the right to say, if you don't listen to me after what you've seen, then I'm going to just dust my boots off and move on to the next guy, and thanks a lot for listening. He had that right. We don't have that right. You don't make no judgments on your fellow man because you're one of them men and you're just as putrid as all men always have been. Just because you have this gift of a covering for having that putridness on you, doesn't make you different. Just makes you covered. You better not be walking around with a feeling of superiority over anybody else, because it's specifically warned against. Don't do that. That's not what it's all about. What it's all about is love God above all things, love your neighbor like you love yourself, and do unto others as you'd have others do unto you. And finally, to remember who it was that paid the price. Who's telling you this? What I did. And he did what he told the young ruler, that if you want to be perfect, you have to do. You give up everything. You give it to the poor. You follow him. And he said, and there's only one place to go after that to be perfect, and that's to lay down your life for your friend. And so before you can even think of becoming perfect, you better be doomed. You better have graduated, I should say, up to loving your neighbor as yourself. You see, and it's an impossibility. It's a paradox. It's the same thing. The law was a paradox to the Jews. They couldn't keep it. And it's supposed to bring you the same message. You need salvation. So that's what drives you to Christ when God is calling you, because many are called, but only few are chosen. Few make that choice to follow him. Now, you don't have to give up everything to follow him. Not at all. He explains that. Those who are around at the end, that judgment, he separates them into sheep and goats, and he tells them, come on in. He said, well, wait a minute. When have we ever done those things? He says, you know, clothed them, fed them, gave them comfort, visited them, gave them to drink, So whenever you did that to the least of my brethren, you did that to me. What's that tell you in the overall picture of the story, what he's looking for out of you is first off to trust him to do what he asks you to do. That came in the lesson of the frankincense. The frankincense had to be made with each of the offerings that were made for their temple sacrifices. Frankincense was taught to them to mean hilarity and joy. It represented hilarity and joy. And by giving that freely, a very expensive item, and burning that before the Lord, that created a sweet odor to his nose. To him. And you know what a sweet odor does. It puts a smile on your face. And so he's smiling at those people, but yet those people at the end don't trust him, don't believe in him, don't even know him. And those who do, he says that they say, we're talking about now the people of this church and this time when this is all coming to an end, they say they have gained wealth and they have need of nothing. That's what they say. The people of this time, who are the church of this time. Not all of them. There's some of them over here in the previous church that are Philadelphians who are have the brotherly love, who are, you know, on the path of loving their neighbor like they love themselves. Love God above all things. And are, in fact, you know, making sure that when they see someone who's hungry, they feed them. And when they see somebody who needs some clothes, they make sure they get it. And they do the things that represent following Christ. Perfection, don't try to get it because it ain't there for you. It's a paradox. You can't do it. And because you have found this in your heart to live this life of doing unto others, you know, and the others are the least of his brethren, then you're doing it to him, and you are acting as he asked. And the frankincense, you're doing it with hilarity and joy. And he asks that you do it for him, to him. He wants this offering with hilarity and joy. What did he ask for? He asked for a loaf of bread. He didn't ask for money. What is bread? Bread's the staff of life, right? So it is the life that you give that your money buys. The gift is to God. And when you put it up on his altar, you let go of it just like you do in the example that I gave earlier. It doesn't belong to you anymore. It's a gift. You gave it to God. He does what he wants with it. God gave you this gift. You do what you want with it. What are your choices? Well, to love or to not love. Those are your two choices. Because he came and said, it's love. Forgive. You see? That's what it's about. Religion has made it about sin. That's a very bad angle to come from. Because your sins were forgiven by this gift. Past, present, and future. You're forgiven. Forgiven is forgiven. Now, what are you doing about the fact that you're forgiven? You holding it high and making yourself mighty over your fellow man? Are you judging him? You know? Are you hiding from the poor? Do you not find the joy of giving to the storehouse where you get your meat enough to just do it? All of these things are a mirror that God left in his logos. He left you a mirror to look into. It's just like he gave them a mirror in the temple, made out of burnished gold that was concave, and when you looked at it, or convex rather, when you looked into it, it magnified you so that you could really see who you were, whether you had dirt on you or not. Then it was full of water, and he's the living water. That's why this laver is a representative or a representation of Christ. The salvation is right there. You have the mirror. The mirror is Christ. You look into that. Are you up to that? Oh, absolutely not. Why? Well, because I commit all these sins? No! No. That's not the reason. The reason is you're not loving. Man is man. And in this dimension, the things that he does are what everything that he does is considered sinful, because it is not in that realm of God, it's in this realm of man on the earth. That's what we have to come to realize. The standard is love, not committing sins. Sins are forgiven. Sin is hamartia. Hamartia means falling short of the glory of God. Having fallen short, being born short of the glory of God, all you need is the gift of salvation. And then you have your free will to make up your mind whether you want to live this, let's put it in parentheses, moral standard of living versus an immoral standard of living. Now, those are in quotes, folks. I'm not trying to say what is or what is not moral. I'm just trying to say that one is white, one is black. And you're on the road. Sometimes you're in the black road, sometimes you're in the white road. But he's clear about that, too. He's, I'm welcoming you back with open arms. Come on back. You come to your senses, you say, oh my goodness, Lord, forgive me. Oh yes, yes, now you're back. Why? Oh, you're already forgiven, and you're recognizing the fact that he's there to forgive you, and that he already did, and you got nothing more to say. You're ashamed, and you say, forgive me. And he says, oh yeah, no problem, pal. Stay on the road. 15 minutes later, 2 minutes later, 30 seconds later, you're off the road again. You see? But you're not driving down a new road that's taking you so far from God that you finally agree with the Nietzscheites of the world that the God is dead. Your God. Because when you got there, he gives you this word that is, again, metaphorically understood within you, that you've committed this unpardonable sin. It's unpardonable because you made the decision to want no pardon. And so then he shuts your mind. He closes the door because you walked out and you slammed it. So he said, okay, you can have your way. That's your decision. And now you're damned to whatever that is. I'm not getting into that. But in that case, you say, you see, you gave him back the gift. I don't want it. Keep it. And he says, okay, thank you. Goodbye. So you don't get that gift. You had it, but you gave it away. And that's the only unpardonable thing, because how can he give it back to you? You won't take it. His word says that he's waiting with open arms. Every time you leave the road, they get back on. He's giving you the headlight. You know, he puts the light on the ground so you can see right where the path is. And the path is not perfection, my friend. The path is simply to observe how Jesus did it and follow that. Forgive. You know? You don't have the power to work miracles. You only have the power to ask God to work miracles in your life. in that relationship, you see, you have this relationship going because you trust him. And you take everything to him, you see. And it keeps you on that road more than you're off the road because your mind is occupied with him. Well, that doesn't make you any better than anybody else. It just makes your life easier. Because if you could live as he tells you to live in this world, it would be heaven. But you can't. Because the devil owns this world, and the devil's got a hold of you just like he's got a hold of everybody else on this earth. And God is that one shining light that gets through in his world. In the devil's world, God honors the fact that we gave it to him. Adam and Eve gave it to him. Until he wins it back through his method of getting it back, that will be so. So you're subject to that. And he says he gives you armor to wear, to, you know, and a helmet, the hope of salvation. Hope is not, I wish I'd get it. No, hope is anticipation with pleasure that you got it. And I find it a really criminal that today people are so far from the truth of the Logos of God that I can understand that why he says when he comes back and he finds all of these people that are being labeled the Laodicean church, that how what he sees what they when he sees what they've done with his gift, it makes him sick to his stomach. See, he throws up. He spits you out. Does that mean you lost your salvation? He took it back? I don't think so. Well, I'm not here to argue that point. That's personal opinion. I don't think so. I think that he still loves them. Just, you know, he still loves them. He gave them a gift, and he still loves them. And they didn't avail themselves of the reward because of that. Then they missed the reward. But what does that mean? I don't know. That's not where my mind goes. All I know is I know what he said. And then I know that we're in the time and that what he really wanted you to do with that example of those Laodiceans was put up a mirror so you can look in there and make sure you're not one of them. Because if you're not one of them and you're following him, then you're over here in the Philadelphia church. And in the Philadelphia church, his promise is, I'm coming quickly. I'm holding the door open for you for two reasons. You kept my word, and you remembered my name. And so now that we're in a time when the dots are getting so close together that they form their own picture, we don't have to connect them anymore. They just are. Especially when you're sitting up in the balcony and you're paying attention to the whole tapestry that has been woven across time. And we're over here now in the right-hand corner of it, just about ready to finish it up on the right-hand edge, down at the bottom in the corner. So you can relate it to the rest of that tapestry and see how it got there. Understand where we are and now start paying attention to what God really said. Put that mirror up and start to examine yourself because that's what it takes over and over again because you got to get used to looking into those eyes that is deceiving you into believing something different about whether it's there is no God and God is dead or I couldn't possibly be one of those persons because I am such a good man that God gave me all of these things. Yes, he did. But what he's looking for was what did you do with them? Did you hoard them or did you make sure that when there was someone to feed that was hungry, you fed them? And the things that actually make a difference to God. Not how much money you have. He says, store up your treasures in heaven. If he gave you abundance, then you're expected, you would be expected to pass that on to those same people that he passed it on to, the folks that don't have it, that need help. In whatever way, in your circle that you know. Oh, well, I give to United Fund campaign. Good. Good. But if you go to your church and you know there are people in town that are really hungry and out of work and homeless and this and that, what effort do you make toward them? Do you even think about them? Or does your church even have a gate up so they can't get in? I don't know. I just know what I've seen, and I know that that exists. And it's not me holding up the mirror, folks. I'm pointing at the mirror that Jesus put there for you to look into. And you're not taking it as that. I'm not saying you as an individual. I'm saying that the world is not understanding it as that. And the judgment of yourself has to come from you, not from me. I don't want you to judge me either. You don't know what's in my mind. And what we need to be is thankful, not proud, that we have this gift. Accept the gift, and when you look and see what it really is, eternal life. Whatever that means, however that works, don't go making any, you shouldn't even have any thoughts, only good thoughts about that's got to mean something wonderful. I would want to live forever. I wouldn't want to live forever the way I'm living right now. I'm glad there's an end to this for you, for myself. I don't have to continue to live through the tyranny that's coming and all of these other kind of things. With the hope that I make the rapture, that I'm alive for that. Well, I will be alive when it happens. I'll be brought back from the dead. He will keep his word. And we know when. It will happen on first fruits. Just as it did, because it was a shadow of things to come, Paul said. For the Jews. That's why he said, watch the Jews, and you'll see if you're living in that time. You'll see these shadows coming to light. And so when, a few years ago, when I heard what Roy Neuberger was saying, I read his books. I wanted him on my show. It was Birkat HaShemah coming up. The blessing on the sun only comes around once every 28 years. Only happens two other times in history. Where the blessing on the sun happens the day before Passover. In the time of Moses, and in the time of Esther and Mordecai. Both times were salvation to the Jews. And now the third one and final one. They know. And if you go into the astronomy where you can go set any date and see the stars, you'll never find these two colliding or passing on the same day again, because one is the moon and one is the sun. The basis of it is the sun and the moon. And so I wanted to know, what do they feel about this? And that's what I interviewed Roy Neuberger about the first time. You can listen to my broadcast on that. I think it'll be published on the new site very shortly. We're still building that site, and we want to thank you for responding to it. And the idea now, of course, is to get your whole mind and body in tune to where we really are, what you really believe, who you see in that mirror, and what you do about it. This is the wake-up call. I said it would come to this when I began it, because if we were going to be the Gideon's army that I thought we would, then I knew way back then that Gideon only wound up with 300, and if God wanted 300 and I had to use my life over all these years to watch and bring that message to you, I would do it. As long as he provided, and his provision came that were in the way of frankincense, because when you give that offering to the Lord, that loaf of bread to the Lord, He does with it what he wants. You see? And so he says, you give to the storehouse where you get your meat. And I'm a storehouse keeper. And I'm here to do that watching and my reporting. My point of view and my personal agenda is, there is no personal agenda. The agenda is information from the balcony. And we'll be doing the balcony show with Raymond as often as we can now. Hopefully I can do it once a week again. And that's what we're going to shoot for anyhow. Until this stuff really starts coming down. And from what Pastor Biltz published about the new, about the red moons and the eclipses and all, I've had letters, people telling me that, you know, it's pretty convincing evidence that this coming year, which the Jews are already in, 2015, looks like it could be it. Well, okay, I'm a watcher. I'm not a prognosticator. Never, ever, ever could you find a program where I said it was going to happen at this time or that time, because I don't do that, except for the exact moment in time on what day, but not what date, because Paul told us that, you know, Feast of the Jews are the shadows of things to come. The Feast of the Jews that brought the Messiah were the spring feasts. Died on Passover in the tomb during unleavened bread, raises on first fruits, goes to heaven 40 days later, and 10 days after that, he's announced as the Messiah by the apostles on Pentecost, the second day of first fruits. That's the schedule. That is, and you can't call it not a schedule, because those are the order of the feasts and how they happen and what they are celebrated for. First fruits celebrated for as the fulfillment of the promise, the full harvest yet to come. It's the promise of the full harvest yet to come, and Jesus fulfills that. He is the promise of the full harvest yet to come for them. We're grafted onto them. We're riding in with them. You say, well, boy, there aren't going to be many of them riding in. Well, that's not the point. The point is that there is still a remnant after all of the tortures and Holocaust brought upon themselves over these years, because they're the ones who did the deeds that brought that on them. And, you know, whether they were falsely accused or whatever in some cases, but all through history, they were not a very loved people, but a necessary part of the structure of the world at the time, because they could do business with both sides, the Muslims and the Christians in the early days. And you know how middlemen make out pretty well. And they did, and then they became hated for it, because they gained power. But we don't want to go down that hole either, because right now we're trying to stay right here on the surface where you can see the story is available. The Logos of God is a story. You see it being filled out in the history that is happening right where you are. And the message is, look in the mirror. You're in the Philadelphia church. You know what the qualifications are. You remember my name, you keep my word. What's his word? Love your neighbor as you love yourself. Love God above all things, and do unto others as you'd have them do unto you. That's his word. That's his command. Not don't commit sins. He never said that. He said to the sinners, go your way. Show them. Go to the Pharisees and show them that you don't have leprosy. And those lepers didn't even stop to take a look. They just ran down there and said, hey, brothers, look at this. And they opened up their shirt, and they haven't got leprosy, and they knew it. Why did they know it? Because God said it, and they believed it. They acted on his word. That's what he's asking you to do. Act on his word. Trust that he's going to keep his word. And now you've lived time 30 years, the last 34 years in history, if you're as old as I am, or if you're at least that old, seeing his word come to pass. The story that he told through his prophet Daniel and the others. Daniel was the only sealed one, so nothing else could happen until Daniel was seen. And when Daniel's being seen, then the other ones could come into play. That's what this ministry's been about for all these years. Keeping you informed. This is an information ministry. and it's supported by God. God taps you people who are listening on the shoulder and said, hey, keep this thing alive. Don't let that die out. You turn the dial around the dial all the way around. You don't find anybody talking like this. Christianity is something different. Christianity is a religion. I'm not part of that religion. But I am here to talk to everybody. Christians, Muslims, atheists, even tax collectors. The only broom bringing a message. I'm pointing out something. This is happening in history because you can prove it. I have the evidence of it. I've kept the log of it. And here's the mirror at this time to see whether you're one of them Philadelphians or whether you're in one of these Laodiceans. Do you want God to be sick to his stomach when he comes and sees you? That's up to you. You got the gift. Make him sick or make him happy. What happens to him if you make him sick? I don't know. What happens to him if you make him happy? You get eternal life. That's what he said. And he warns you. In this time, it's so easy to think that God is dead. This great apostasy, this falling away from God, is not at its beginning. It's almost at its end. There's only very few. He said this Philadelphia church, is, you don't have many. You're very weak. There's not many of you left. Why? Because the world has been stealing them over into the other church that makes them feel that their goods are more important than on earth than they are storing them up in heaven. And God said, don't do that. Hang on to what you got. Not your money, your goods. Hang on to that faith that you have that keeps you over here in this other era of the church. The era of the brotherly love. And the story contains the mirror. And when you see the story, then you understand who Jesus of Nazareth was, the Christ. And that he's the reflection that you're supposed to see when you're looking in the mirror. That you're following him. That you can look into your eyes and understand and know, I belong to Jesus. You don't have to enumerate to him what it is that you do. He reads your heart. You got him in your heart. And I love what John said. John said, you know, how can you say that you love God, who you've never seen, if you don't love your brother, your own flesh and blood, who you can see? Now hold that little mirror up, or be thinking of that when you look into the mirror and see what that says to you. You know? And think of what James says when he says, you know, faith without works is dead. Let's change the word works to deeds, because that's what God's looking for, deeds. Faith without deeds is dead. What kind of faith have you got? He said, Jesus said, it's apistis, that kind of faith. The word translated faith from the Greek is pistis, P-I-S-T-I-S. Put an A in front of that and it changes the meaning. It means the other direction. You see, now pistis, the definition of pistis is faith, action based upon a belief and sustained with confidence. You see? Everything else that isn't that is going in the other direction. It's faith in the wrong direction. Doesn't say you haven't got faith. Because you're going the wrong direction with it. You got to turn around and go the other way. Don't think that all those blessings that God has bestowed upon you were to show the rest of the Christian world that if they acted like you, then they would have these things. That's nonsense. Those things are your test. Give it all away. Sell it. Give it to the poor. Follow me. That's what he told the young ruler, and the young ruler couldn't do it, so he walked away all unhappy. After having kept the law, Jesus said, oh, well, that's wonderful, wonderful. Now you've got one thing left to do. Sell everything you got, give it to the poor, and follow me. And if you really want to be perfect, lay down your life for your friend. Then he walked away, all upset. Wow, ooh, boy, I can't do that. Jesus didn't say that's what you had to do to be saved. You got to do to be saved, you got to love your neighbor. Love God above all things. Do unto others, you'd have them do unto you. That's the gift of salvation requirement. Now you got a gift. Now you got free will. You live in the world. You got life in front of you. What do you do with it? Well, if you live in the modern day age, what most people have done with it and say, well, God is dead. Forget about that. And look for something else. Too bad they came to that conclusion. I sure wish I had a big base of listeners from that end of the world. And Tony's trying to do something about that. Because his presentation on the philosophy that you can count on producing this love is God. So God is not dead. Because love is not dead in the world yet. But it's waxing cold, isn't it? Like he said it would at this time. So you got to this time look out for yourself. There's not time to try and look out for everybody else. You got to look out for yourself. It's your salvation that's at stake. Your gift. He said, hang on to your gift. Don't let anybody steal it from you. Don't. Look in the mirror. Look into your eyes. Look deep into your souls. It's time for your end of time checkup. Find out where you stand now and to be so thankful that you even understand that you should be looking to see where you stand. Because I don't think you're in the Philadelphia church if you're not even thankful for this message. Because I know it's not going to be popular with those who are not in the Philadelphia church. But we're not here to win a popularity contest. We're here to point out that there is a mirror and you should be looking at it and don't kill the messenger. That's what I've got to say today, folks. I want to hear from you. Let me know. How'd you like Raymond and the balcony show? And tell me what you think of the new direction or the direction that I'm going to take now, because I'm going to continue to talk about this mirror. While I continue to analyze and watch the milestones in the Middle East happen. And watch what's going on with the Jews so that we, between all three of those things, keeps us busy enough to have God in the forefront of our mind. Having our faith sustained by seeing the Logos of God and the wonder of how it actually is coming to pass. So if this is a storehouse where you get your meat, then stand up and cheer loudly. Now that cheering is for the frankincense, that the hilarity and joy of giving to God, because it's offering time. And we thank you very much for those offerings. And we appreciate your support. And tell your friends, stop by brosal.org. That's brosal.org. And sign up to receive my weekly broadcast right into your email box.